Blessed express the abundantly so as I know that I am. Now ask it all in the gracious name of Jesus Christ.
And then it can back on the
can I get you comforted in this place? Where I go?
Thank you.
of us having taken the place of Jesus. He died in his stable in Ephesus when he was too old to walk and had to be carried wherever he went. He would say it over and over again, "When I'm gone, there'll be no one left alive who saw me, who touched me, who walked with me." Revelation chapter 3, beginning with the 11th verse, "Behold," Jesus said, "I come quickly." Revelation 3 and 11. "Behold, I come quickly, and hold that fast which you have, that no man take your crown. Him who overcomes will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out. I will write upon him the name of my God, the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which comes down out of heaven from my God. And I will write upon him a new name. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches." I want to use for subject speaking a few minutes this morning, pillars in the temple of God. Pillars in the temple of God. Would you bow your heads? Heavenly Father, thank you today, Lord, for your grace. Thank you for your mercy, without which we would not be here today. I would ask in the name of Jesus that you would help me to deliver this which I believe you placed in my soul. Not only anointing me to deliver it, but anoint the people to hear it, to receive it into their hearts, that all of us may be a pillar in the temple of God.
Yes.
And Lord, I'll ask it all in the most holy name of Jesus. And everyone said amen. David was a man totally unique, not only in his day, but in the whole of humanity. There has probably never been another one quite like him. He was called the darling of Israel, the sweet singer of Israel. The Lord used him to bring music and sing, both the music, the horns, the instruments and the singing into the places of worship. The Lord showed him how this was to be done. Thereby he wrote over half the Psalms. Probably the greatest one that he wrote was, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff will comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely the goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever." He knew spiritual highs.
That was always my favorite, Lord.
No other man may have ever known. And he knew spiritual
highs. Still is.
As no other man has ever known. God.
I remember this sermon years ago.
He's a man after my own heart. What a statement. You say, how could God say that of this man?
That's what I thought that was.
Who had sinned as he sinned.
I think this was 2018.
Adultery is bad enough. Murder. And cold-blooded murder. To murder Uriah, who was fighting on the front lines for David and for the Lord.
Oh, we're going to win.
And yet, it says he was a man after God's own heart. You must understand there are no perfect people. There's only one perfect, indeed, his name is Christ. Hallelujah. And my faith in him lets me run out on his coattails to glory. Hallelujah. Somebody ought to shout in this place. Somebody ought to praise God.
It's me.
David. The man after God's own heart. And there came an hour that the Lord moved upon him concerning the building of the temple. Now the terminology is somewhat freighted, because David in his heart said, I want to build a temple for the Lord. The Ark of the Covenant rested in a makeshift affair. And the great prophet came to him and said, do what's in your heart. But the Lord sent him back again and said, no, I'll give David the plans for the temple, but he will not build it. His son Solomon will build it. Every single thing about the temple, the only building on the face of the earth where God dwelt, was in heaven. He now dwells in a tabernacle, a rude affair, a crude affair. But a temple will be built. In today's dollars, it would cost over $1 trillion for that building to be constructed. Solomon employed 153,600 men, and it took some 7 years. You think of this. God would dwell in the Holy of Holies between the mercy seat and the cherubim. The God of heaven, no nation on the face of the earth had such a thing. No people had such a thing. God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, God who created man out of the dust of the earth and breathed into him, and man became a living soul. God would dwell in the Holy of Holies, where that only the high priest could go in, and only one time a year on the great day of atonement. Thank God, every day now is a great day of atonement. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Whenever God gave David these plans, David did not contribute one iota to the drawings, to the plans, to the schematic. He never contributed anything. He never said, Lord, I think this would look good this way. I think this would go good here. He wrote down only what the Lord told him to say, and drew off only what the Lord told him to, specifying that God is the God of salvation, not man.
What was he saying?
The man puts his sense into it. That's what it summit. Are you listening to me? This is the problem of the church. It tries to add to
rapping
this
hard, book,
or take this book, or ignore this book.
10:04 p.m.
That's the problem in the United States of America today. It is ignoring this book that I hold in my hands. Now, there's always been sin, but there are certain sins that God doesn't take kindly to answer. Some sins end with more than others. leaders of this nation in abortion. That is a despicable crime. It is a crime against humanity. Millions of unborn babies. Abortion is murder. Now, lady, if you are watching me now and you have suffered an abortion in the past, I will not label you with guilt. Ask God to forgive you. He will do it. And to erase the scar and promise him you'll meet that little one in the portals of glory, and you will deserve Jesus Christ. The second problem is homosexual marriages. This is an abomination in the eyes of God. Now, I'm not saying this to bang or to speak disparagingly of individuals as homosexuals. I will say this. You were not born that way. But that needs a little explanation. Due to the fall and the Garden of Eden, every single baby that is born, including me, you, they, them, is born with certain proclivities toward certain wrong directions. You follow what I'm saying? You'll find the movie actress that walks in and steals a $10 handkerchief, and she's got $1 million in the bank. There's a proclivity there in her or him to do this thing, more so than it would be me or you. There are some people who, from the time of a child, cannot tell the truth. They would rather lie and tell the truth when the truth will help them. They're born with their problem. You say, well, aren't they born? Everybody's born in original sin. And there are certain proclivities in that original sin that bends toward that which is wrong. And there are individuals who are born with a proclivity toward homosexuality. That doesn't mean they're born a homosexual. If that's the case, when everybody is shot down. Because Jesus Christ is the answer for the original sin problem. No, you didn't hear me. I said Jesus Christ is the answer and the only answer for the original sin problem. I remember talking to a man here in the city. Francis and I have been a friend of his and he of us for several years. I didn't know he was homosexual. He said, well, would that have totally severed your friendship if you had known? No, it wouldn't. I would have still been as kind and gracious to that man as I would otherwise. When we heard about his problem, there was a problem. We went to his place of business, Francis and I did. He stood there and cried and sobbed. He said, I fought this thing all my life. He came close to allowing Jesus Christ to have a place in his life, but the last time I saw him, there seemed to be no inclination toward him. Now, let me tell you, will a homosexual go to hell because he's a homosexual? Will a thief go to hell because he's a thief? Will a liar go to hell because he's a liar? No, shock you. No. You'll go to hell because you reject Jesus Christ. Thank God for Jesus Christ! Thank God for Jesus Christ! Thank God for Jesus Christ! And this gay marriage thing, the nation is slapping the face of God. so loved that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting. One man the other day said, well, if they will allow marriage, men with men, women with women, I'm going to marry myself. But wait, right? It's not what you think. There was no perversion intended. The state said, you can't marry your son because it would be incest. So no, it wouldn't be because we can't bear children. Why are you doing it? Because of the laws of the land. When I die, if he's my son, and my son only, the government gets every dollar I've got. But if he's married to me, he'll get everything I've got. You got some people smarter than the government. Have you ever figured that out? That man was nobody's fool. Did he marry his son? I don't think I would do such a thing. I don't care if the government got all my $10. But once you open the door, let me tell you, Lauren Larson said right over the message of the cross the other morning, this problem of gay marriage is not a civil rights problem. It is a moral problem. Marriage is the underpinning of the family and of society and has been for 6,000 years. And now some bright-eyed boys in the government have said we know more than God knows. No, you're going to wreck the nation if you keep up what you're doing. The only answer for sin is Jesus Christ. There is no other, no other. The Lord told David exactly what to build, although he wouldn't build it, his son Solomon would. As I stated, it would cost over $1 trillion in today's money. Solomon employed 153,600 men working 7 years to build that thing, where God dwelt between the mercy seat and the cherubim. Now, as I stated, David contributed nothing toward the design. Nothing. And man cannot contribute anything toward the work. He's not writing more Bibles. This is it. This is it. When John closed it out, that closed out the canon of Scripture. All right. The building of the temple was somewhat a picture of sanctification. Of course, it included justification, but as it has to, it couldn't be otherwise. Sanctification, and I'll show it to you as we go along. This was a picture, the way that structure was built. A picture of the sanctification of the child of God. At a given point in time, David, even though he couldn't build the temple, could prepare for it, which he did. He took the kingdom of Israel to the borders that God had told Abraham that Israel wants to have. A far cry from that little spit of land that's about the size of the state of Vermont, if that, is called Israel today. Whenever the kingdom age commences, Israel will once again have the borders that God originally promised Abraham. Syria, Lebanon, all the way to the Euphrates, half of Iraq becomes Israel. All of the Arabic Peninsula, which is a very big plot of ground, will become Israel. There will be no more Saudi Arabia, things of that nature in the kingdom. David took all of that, all the way to the Suez Canal in the Sinai Peninsula. He took it all. And in the defeating of these great armies that he defeated, the Bible said that he took in much gold, much silver, and the scripture said great quantities of brass or copper. What in the world does all that have to do with anything? Wait a minute. He took thousands and thousands of brass altar rails, heathen brass altars, brass doorknobs, all of these things that constituted heathenism. He took it all and took it to Jerusalem and put it in warehouses to await the building of the temple. Now listen. Some Christians think if so-and-so would just get saved, that they're going to do a lot for God. They may could. But because they are a success in the Lord, doesn't mean they're going to be a success for the Lord. The Lord cannot use anything that the world has. Are you listening to me? Do you hear what I'm saying? And some of you here in this place may wonder. Some by radio, by television, by the internet. Why won't God use me? He put all of that brass, all of that gold and silver in the warehouses and just stayed there. Why? Because before it could be used in the temple, before it could be used in the house of God, certain things had to be done. Moses spent 40 years at the backside of the desert. 40 years. Amen. 40 years. And the call of God on his life and him tending a little group of sheep. Abraham, 25 years. Isaac, 20 years. David, 15 years. Because it took Moses about 40 hours to get out of Egypt, and it took 40 years to get Egypt out of Moses. He said, well, bless God, I'm saved, filled with the Spirit, I'm ready to go. I know you aren't ready to go. You think you are ready to go, but to use some bad grammar, you ain't. Glory. Hallelujah. Put it in those warehouses. God wants to use, so let me tell you this. Sometimes he's using you, and you don't really know he's using you. Because you've got your mind set on something that he's not planned for you. Let me help you with something. Well, David went up into the Euphrates, and he attacked that powerful captain by the name of Hadarezer, whose king was Zobah, one of the most powerful armies in the world. David's troops, his mighty men and others who were with him. I mean, they won tremendous victories because the Lord was in it. Those soldiers who were with David, if you had told them 3,000 years later, preachers will be preaching about what you did and telling about what you did. On the other side of the world, they would have looked at you like you were crazy. thing at that time on the face of the entire earth. You think I'm going to just say it? You say, well, you may be wrong. I don't think I am. I believe the message of the cross right now is the single most important thing on the face of the entire earth. And your participation in it, your part in it, what you do, you say, well, Brother Swagger, I can't do a lot, but you can pray. You can seek the face of God. There's not a saint of God who cannot pray. And it is, I think, down to the little spoons. God designed it all. God designed your salvation. He designed it. And then he gave certain men ability and talent to do what they did. But then he gave instructions. Go get all the car. Wagon will take it. We need to build the pillars. Now the strange thing about these pillars, pillars always hold up something normally. But those pillars didn't hold up anything. They just sat in front of the temple. And I'll get to that in a little bit. They just sat in front of the temple. No portico over, no porch over, nothing. They just stood. One was named Jacob, the other one was named Boaz. The first one means established. The second one means strength. They took all of that tons, because those pillars were 60 feet tall. 60 feet tall, huge things, made of solid concrete. They were not hollow like what we have today. They were solid. Took them to a place called Sukkot. I'm not that man for you. We'll find fault for God's intent. There was the ground there was such called the clay ground of Sukkot.
That's what they do on those.
To where they could build a mold and put all of these copper doorknobs, copper
almost 10:30 p.m.
Altar rails, copper altars from heathen, all of that's got to be eliminated.
You're using the front right up here, bring this storm in there.
They dug out the trench and built the fort.
Make a dope that she went to sleep. They should be back. She was sleeping right. She kept starting to do a more evil.
And you're getting the message. That fire melted the whole thing. What you had before has got to be melted. Oh, but you just don't understand. I was an altar rail from the heathenistic god of Baal. I know God will use me. I remember driving out here one day, going to the radio station, and a fellow in a pickup truck stopped me. I didn't know who was. I rolled out of my window. He says, I'm Elvis Presley.
I remember it. Guess the name.
What's the name? no skepticism in the case. I'm Elvis Presley's brother. Even if it was. I knew of him, but I didn't know him. And he talked a few moments. He's trading on the name of Elvis Presley. The Lord didn't have anything to do with him. I said, well, brother, God bless you, I gotta go.
Now you gotta hear who's on it.
That copper, heathenistic altar had to be melted. And some of us, I'll put myself in it. We may think we've been in sucker too long. You say, I've never heard this kind of preaching before. Well, that's all right. Sucker is where we need to be. And when he gets through with us, he'll let us know. And they came and got those pillars. Huge, 60 feet tall. You think of those things. I don't know how far it is to that ceiling up there. That was probably pretty close, 6 feet. And set those things up right in front of the temple. Like I said, one was named Jacob, the other was named Boaz. Jacob means established. Boaz means spiritual. They didn't hold up anything. And yet Jesus said, I'll make you to be a pillar in the temple. What are you getting at? I'm getting at this. Those pillars were just one invitation. They were not needed to hold up the structure. They didn't hold up anything. They just stood there. We aren't needed. You follow me? We aren't needed. We're just ornamentation. But God loves us so much that he put us right in the front. Glory to God. Hallelujah. 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 What about Jesus? Full of salvation. All victory.
Thank you, Lord.
Wait a minute. It is said that during the days of Solomon, when the known world of that day was beating a path to Israel, the Mount of Olives sits right in front of where the temple stood, facing the east. I've been there. The last time that I can recall, or maybe the time before, I wanted to get there before daylight, and we did. I took my television people with us, and John Starnes with. And had John to sing Jerusalem as the sun is coming up over the Mount of Olives. But be that as it may, in those days of 3,000 years ago, travelers would come and would purposely camp outside the gates open up. And they would walk before the Mount of Olives. And when that sun would rise above all of that, it would hit those pillars made of copper, shine to perfect perfection. And it was like a million lights going off all over Jerusalem. We are not needed. He doesn't have to help us. His love, he allows us to be a part. And when the sun, you say, well, I have God with me. Yes, I know you do. When the sun, that's not this you in now, it's S-O-N. When it rises above and the reflection hits us, and that light is not your light, It's not your light. It's not my light. It's his light. Glory to God. Praise God. I'll make you, he said, to be a pillar in the temple of my God. Praise God. Praise God that we have this privilege. Have thy own way, Lord. Have thy own way. Thou art the Father. Thank you.
good.
Yeah.